That's good, okay. Had just three different setup on things like sound systems.
I'm gonna feel like Jack White playing.
You feel like Jack White, because I've never seen that.
I have some pictures.
Thank you.
So I went to the ant chamber, one chamber, where the big chamber is back up here, so I'm gonna get it replaced.
There's some, there's some dust in here. Music. There's some, what is the bad music?
Unbelievable. We're still in time.
He's a famous country artist.
And it turned, it set a little bit different than what it was. Look up here, it's across. It's awesome.
So set a starter thing, you know, quiet, and she comes.
Set my physical state. But like I said, the roof here, it's just a big raise. You don't see, in three quarters of it, they're six. Not staying.
Yeah, it's a guitar.
We were down under the steps, and they were dirt and sand coming through the brick, and I don't know which, and my girl was mad. But it's, I said, that's the car.
So for this first time, everything, the way it was fine.
That was quite bad. School didn't work.
See, and water.
Here starts this, to start the program, I don't know if y'all have, didn't hand out the lyrics?
I didn't, no.
That's all right, that's all right.
We figured.
I'll sing it one time, real simple. Y'all wanna sing along, I'm gonna go through it a few times, just a little phrase on those sanctuary, I'm sure you guys, most of you have heard. Feel free to sing along. Lord, prepare me. Be a sanctuary. Pure and holy. Shining true.
Amen. Thank you, Scott. Good evening, and welcome back to our second Lenten study, Entering the Passion of Jesus, from Amy Jill Levine's book of the same name. You'll have to excuse me, my mask got caught. And for those of you joining us for the first time tonight, my name is Marianne Heinzman, and I'm a student at Phillips Theological Seminary. And Mr. Scott Pates is providing the wonderful music for us during our Lenten studies. Tonight we're going to continue the story of Jesus as he goes through the Passion Week in the of Jerusalem, and this time we're going to look at the book of Mark. Tensions between the prophet from Nazareth and the imperial forces of Rome are going to increase, and once again, Jesus will risk his reputation in a display of righteous anger. And I will pose the questions this evening: why was Jesus angry? And exactly what is Jesus risking his reputation for? So in that spirit, let us once again enter into a time of meditation to quiet our minds and our hearts. So I invite you at this time to close your eyes and to take a few deep cleansing breaths. And as you breathe in, silently invite the Holy Spirit into our space this evening. And as you breathe out, let go of the items that you have yet to cross off your to-do list. Breathe in the compassion that flows from the heart of the Holy One. And breathe out any irritations that may have surfaced during the day. And finally, as you breathe in, allow the Holy Spirit's healing presence to fill your mind and your heart and your body. And as you breathe out, settle into the pew or the chair in which you are sitting. And with your eyes still closed, imagine once again that you are that Jewish pilgrim having come to Jerusalem for the Passover feast. And you recall yesterday's exciting parade as you followed the prophet Jesus of Nazareth. And your soul soars with hope. Finally, someone has seen your plight. But today you are hurrying along the narrow streets toward the temple and the vendors that will be selling the goats and the sheep and the doves for the animal sacrifices. Your hand is held tight within your robes, clutching the few precious coins you have brought with you from home. Your family has worked for many weeks to save the money necessary for the obligatory animal sacrifice. And this year, you hope that it will be enough for a small goat. If not, you will have to make do with the two doves as you have in years past. Suddenly, out of nowhere, a young boy jostles you as he runs by, causing you to lose your step on the uneven surface of the road. As you brace yourself to keep from falling, you lose your grip on the coins, and they fall to the ground, rolling out of reach among the feet of the passersby. You are only able to recover one of the coins. Your chest instantly fills with shocked surprise and then dismay as you watch the young boy retreat. Anger slowly takes hold. You may open your eyes. This is probably not the twist of fate we might have been expecting on our way to the temple. Were you surprised by how fast your emotions went from jubilant to angry? These coins were not easy to come by, after all. As we turn to our scripture passage this evening, we see that Jesus is caught in similar emotions. Will you please stand if you are comfortably able for the reading of the Gospel from Mark chapter 11, verses 15 through 19. Then they came to Jerusalem, and he entered the temple and began to drive out those who were selling and those who were buying in the temple. And he overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. And he would not allow anyone to carry anything through the temple. He was teaching and saying, "Is it not written, 'My house shall be called a house of prayer for all nations'? But you have made it a den of robbers." And when the chief priests and the scribes heard it, they kept looking for a way to kill him, for they were afraid of him, because the whole crowd was spellbound by his teaching. And when evening came, Jesus and his disciples went out of the city. The word of the Lord. You may be seated. I have to admit, I've struggled with this story all week. And I sometimes have a passion or a problem, and it's my own problem, in wrestling with the angry Jesus. However, I picked the Mark passage because the Gospel of Mark was one of the earliest Gospels written. In fact, it was the earliest Gospel written. And Jesus is portrayed as more human, so we see more of the humanity in Jesus in this Gospel. And I also think, as we go through this story, that possibly we can just relate a little bit more in our own humanity with this Jesus. Our passion story this evening is once again chock full of conflict and risk. Known in many accounts as the cleansing of the temple, I would suggest that perhaps a better term would be an incident. And to fully understand this incident and its true implications, we must first have a thorough understanding of the setting of the story, the temple in Jerusalem. Because as we explore the structure and the function of the Jewish temple, we may find that our thoughts are steered not so much to the importance of what Jesus does, but the importance of what Jesus says. Let's begin our study. The first thing that we need to know about the temple is that it was still under construction during the time of Jesus, and it had several different courtyards. In the middle of the temple was the inner sanctum called the Holy of Holies. Now, Jewish men, usually of the Levite tribe, would take turns serving as priests in the temple. And some of their jobs would include offering up incense on the altar and also other priestly duties. We see this in Luke's birth narrative when Elizabeth's husband Zechariah serves in the temple. But the only man that was allowed to enter the Holy of Holies was the man appointed as the high priest. And he only entered the Holy of Holies once a year on Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. And he did this in order to ask forgiveness for himself and for the people. Now, surrounding the inner sanctum, the Holy of Holies, was the court of the priests. So I imagine this is where the regular priests would go about their daily duties. Next, surrounding that, and I have to point out that as we go through the people were allowed into that particular courtyard. And so the next court was the courtyard of Israel. And this was a place for Jewish men to gather. I would imagine that they probably listened to the rabbi's teachings and discussed it among themselves. And surrounding that courtyard was the court of the women. Now, this is a little bit of a misnomer because you might think that only women were allowed in this courtyard, but in fact, it was the courtyard that they invited women to join them. So both men and women were allowed to gather here. And again, it might be a time of socializing, it might be a time of discussing the rabbi's teachings, it might be a time of prayer. And finally, around the court of women was the court of the Gentiles. And the court of the Gentiles welcomed all people to worship there. And I should point out at this time that Jerusalem was a very large, multicultural city. In fact, the Jewish people were probably a minority in the city. And so there were Greeks, and there were Romans, and there were pagans. And they usually, these other cultures, were polytheistic. So they worshipped many gods, or several gods, not just one, as the Israelite people did. And it was common for these Greeks and Romans and even pagans to come to the court of the Gentiles, and they were welcomed there to worship the God of Israel. So for these people, the God of Israel would have been one of the many gods that they worshiped. And so you can see from this visual picture, the whole structure of the temple was quite large. In fact, the length of it would be the same as if you took 12 soccer fields and laid them out end to end. Now, the temple also had many functions. It was a house of prayer and a house of worship and a house of teaching, but it also functioned in other ways as well. First, it was the site of the three pilgrimage festivals of Passover, Shavuot, or Pentecost, and Sukkot, or the Festival of Booths. These were the three festivals that Jewish people were required, if they were able, to come to Jerusalem and celebrate. So in this regard, it was a symbol of Jewish tradition. Similarly, it was the only place in all of the Jewish world where animal sacrifices could be offered. Now you have to remember, at this time we had Jewish people living in Palestine, the area of Galilee and Judea, but we also had Jewish people living in diaspora. So there were Jewish people living in Egypt, in northern Africa, in Greece, Ephesus, Corinth. There were Jewish people spread all throughout. And each of these places where they lived, they would have synagogues in their villages and towns where people could go and gather. But the only place that animal sacrifices could be made was the Jewish temple in Jerusalem. Now, because it wasn't feasible for people making this pilgrimage to Jerusalem to carry their animals with them, the temple also became a marketplace with vendors selling animals, such as goats or sheep or doves, that were without blemish and could be used for the animal sacrifice. So sometimes I think we've either been taught or we get in our head that this marketplace in the temple was a bad thing or was something that Jesus might have been angry at. But in actuality, it was very common to have the marketplace and the vendors there. Now, because the animals were bought with temple coins called Tyrian shekels, now that's a fun fact for all you Game of Thrones fans. You will get that if you watch that show. The temple also served sort of like a national bank. And so there were money changers on hand that would change money from all the foreign currencies into these Tyrian shekels so people could buy their animals for sacrifice. And I also want to point out that none of the gospel texts say that the money changers or the vendors were cheating the people or otherwise exploiting them. That is not in the text at all. And finally, during these pilgrimage festivals, the temple took on the atmosphere of a tourist attraction. We tend to think of the temple similar to our Christian sanctuaries that might be quiet with reflective contemplation. But the Jewish temple was often crowded with many people speaking many different languages and worshiping either in the Gentile court, worshiping the God of Israel, or as you went further in, observing the Jewish laws and practices. And so with this understanding of the setting of our story, we now enter Mark's narrative. Now, Hollywood would lead us to believe that Jesus' actions were fueled by an out-of-control rage that resulted in the slow-motion spewing of golden coins. And so dramatic were his actions, in fact, that some movies didn't have Jesus uttering one word. And in the end, the entire temple is brought to a silent standstill of utter amazement. However, given what we've just learned about the size of the temple and the crowds of people that were in attendance, I highly doubt that Jesus turning over a few tables would have created the entire temple to come to a standstill. So his actions, instead of being the driving force behind the passage, seem to display the emotion that drives Jesus' teaching. And so we have to look at what Jesus is saying. Is it not written, "My house shall be a house of prayer for all the nations, but you have made it a den of robbers"? Jesus is quoting the prophets Isaiah and Jeremiah respectively here. And the irony of Jesus standing in the middle of the court of the Gentiles and proclaiming, "My house shall be called a house of prayer for all nations," the irony should not be lost on us. So what was Jesus so angry about? Why was he overturning tables? If he wasn't angry with the money changers, if they weren't cheating the people, why was he angry? Perhaps Jesus is addressing an insider-outsider culture here. Sometimes human nature causes people to become very comfortable in familiar places and with familiar people. Family gatherings, working with longtime coworkers, and even churches are examples of such places. And as we've seen during the past year, those familiar things often become very important during times of stress, and we tend to cling to that comfort. But I'd like you to think for a moment what it might feel like to be the outsider. Think about when you started a new job. You had new skills to learn, new people to get to know, and you had to figure out the Or maybe you moved to a new town and you didn't know anyone. Now, when Greg and I were first married, we spent 18 months doing a short-term missionary assignment, working at a Christian college in Brussels, Belgium. The college prepared an international student body of Protestant European nationals to return to their home countries as ministers and missionaries. As we prepared to go, I was told by the Belgian consulate in Chicago that I could travel and live in Belgium under Greg's visa, so I didn't need to apply for one of my own. Well, lo and behold, when we arrived, the city officials in the town where we lived said, "Oh, no, 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 you need your own visa." And so I applied for my visa, and 18 months later, when we were ready to go home, all the red tape had been cut through, and I finally had my visa. And on that Brussels is a bilingual city, so people either spoke French or Dutch, and I really felt like the outsider. And sometimes, just like the Jewish temple in Jesus' day, I think it's easy for Christian churches to kind of fall into that same trap. Now, I'm not going to point any fingers here at Emmanuel, but if you've attended the same church that you grew up in, and you've attended all your life, and I do point the finger at myself because I've been a member here for almost 20 years. Sometimes we forget what it's like for a stranger to walk into a new church. And they might be thinking to themselves, what if I sit in somebody's regular spot? What if I can't follow the bulletin or the liturgy? Or worse, no one speaks to me today. Just some food for thought. And while we're on the topic of being comfortable, let's move on to Jesus' quote from Jeremiah. "But you have made it a den of robbers." I think sometimes we misunderstand the term "den of robbers," at least as Jesus uses it here. We often perceive Jesus' actions of overturning the tables to mean that he is angry at the money changers and vendors, perhaps for exploiting the poor Jewish pilgrims. I think that would preach in 21st century America. It sounds like a good social justice sermon, doesn't it? Let's not exploit the poor or the minorities. However, I want to point out that the den of robbers, the den, was not where the thieves did the thieving. Their thieving was done out in the city, out in the world. And then they would come back to their den or their hideout to count the spoils. It's where they felt comfortable doing so, away from the watchful eyes of the authorities. A similar parallel might be a lion's den. The lion's den, or his home, was not where the lion killed its prey, but where it brought the prey to eat it. So I would like to suggest tonight, and believe me, this is hard for me to preach this as I look at my own self, but perhaps Jesus wasn't angry with the money changers nor the vendors, but perhaps he was confronting the comfortable manner in which some of the Jewish pilgrims were treating the house of prayer and worship, and that's why he displayed his righteous anger. Perhaps some were taking divine mercy for granted. Perhaps the temple was no longer a place to seek forgiveness, a place to And so I wonder, sometimes, if modern-day Christians have been become comfortable in their places of worship, and they forget what it's like to be the outsider. Does that affect how we treat the stranger? And for that matter, do we even recognize the stranger in our midst? A stranger could be someone who has sat in our churches for 20 years or 30 years and maybe not felt a part of everything. And so, since Lent is a time of inward introspection and contemplation, I would just ask you to consider this interpretation of the story tonight. You know, it's interesting that John's Gospel records this temple incident a little bit differently than the Synoptic Gospels. In John's account, Jesus says, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and you will raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. Now, in all likelihood, the author of John's Gospel was writing with 20/20 hindsight. In a few short decades, the temple, after the temple incident was supposed to have taken place, the Jewish temple is going to be destroyed. And the followers of Jesus are going to go on to form their own religion, and it will be called Christianity. Jesus' body, and even our own, will come to be regarded as the temple of the Holy Spirit. So as Scott shares a piece of special music tonight, I invite you to contemplate not only why Jesus may have been angry in the temple, but how is his righteous anger challenging us tonight?
Amen.
As our benediction this evening, I would like to leave us with a poem written by Rabbi Harold Kushner, originally published in Parade magazine, to be used by people of all faiths. A prayer for the world, and we might call it a prayer for people of all nations. Let the rain come and wash away the ancient grudges, the bitter hatreds held and nurtured over generations. Let the rain wash away the memory of the hurt, the neglect. Then let the sun come out and fill the sky with rainbows. Let the warmth of the sun heal us wherever we are broken. Let it burn away the fog so that we can see each other clearly. So that we can see beyond labels, beyond accents, gender, or skin color. Let the warmth and brightness of the sun melt our selfishness. So that we can share the joys and feel the sorrows of our neighbors. And let the light of the sun be so strong that we will see all people as our neighbors. Let the earth, nourished by rain, bring forth flowers to surround us with beauty. And let the mountains teach our hearts to reach upward to heaven. Amen. Go in peace.